Good afternoon to one and all, and welcome back for those of you that are returning, and for those of you that are here for your first session, welcome to this, our 19th consecutive and annual Festival of Faiths. I'm Owsley Brown, this year's chairperson, and it's a great honor and pleasure to be connected with this marvelous event. And as you all know, it takes an awful lot of people to put one of these things on. So my job is to do a best attempt at calling some, not all, but some of them out. And I want to start with our financial sponsors, chief among them, Brown-Forman, who have been our partner for so many years, really from the very beginning. And we're incredibly grateful to them, along with the Archdiocese of Louisville, also Hilliard Lyons, Hospice, Norton Healthcare, PNC Wealth Management, and Wyatt, Tarrant, and Combs. Hello to our live streaming audience. Yes, indeed, we are live streaming, and we're so happy about that. And also posting as quickly as we can all of our programs on our YouTube channel. So feel free to check into our website and find those. The YouTube channel button is currently kind of hidden a little bit in the upper right-hand corner of the homepage, but it's there, and we'll try to make that more obvious in the days ahead. This is a zero-waste event. We're happy to be making our best attempt to be a zero-waste event, and there's so much to say about that that I'll save the longer discussion for this afternoon. There'll be a nice reception. All are invited to at the end of today's session. Just quickly about tomorrow, which is our final day of the festival, we have a little change to the program. We have a double session tomorrow morning with Gerardo Abood, which will start as scheduled at 9 o'clock, but continue on for 2 hours, not just one. So for those of you that can make it for that, just know we have an extra hour added, which we're all very happy about. And then a break, and then at 12:30, our longest session of the whole festival, the Awaken the Dreamer program, will start at 12:30 right here. And spread the word about all of this, and not to be forgotten will be tomorrow night's session, which is going to be just a fabulous time with both Ed Bastian and his son, adopted Louisville son Jonathan, and Sheikh Kabir Haminsky and Sheikha Camille Haminsky. So we're very, very excited about that. As you know, there are so many people that are working behind the scenes to make this all happen, and we are led by our fearless leader, Dr. Kathleen Lyons, but on the day-to-day team every day that have had this this ship rolling have been an incredible dedicated full-time staff that include Edie Wooten, Nicole Kowalski, Keith Runyon, Halida Hatic, and Sarah Reed Harris. And so a huge thanks to all of them for making this possible. And I now give you our executive director and fearless leader, Dr. Kathleen Lyons.
Thank you. Thank you, Ausley. And I would like to begin my part of the introduction by acknowledging all of the work, the inspiration, the energy, the imagination of Ausley Brown III, the chair of the 19th Festival of Faiths. We have a wonderful program planned for this afternoon, and we're most grateful to have Nina Simons and Kenny Ausubel to present this program to us. First, I would like to tell you a little about Nina. They will be presenting the program, but not together. Nina will present a program, and then Kenny will present a program. And at the conclusion, there will be more or less a panel of responders to pull it all together. both Nina and Kenny will participate in this, as well as Sarah Reed Harris and Halida Hatic staff. Nina Simons is an award-winning social entrepreneur and visionary thinker. In 1990, she co-founded Bioneers with her husband and partner, Kenny Ausubel. Since then, she has helped to lead the organization through 25 years of identifying, gathering, and disseminating breakthrough innovations in every field of endeavor that reveal a positive and life-honoring future that's within our grasp today. Nina's work currently focuses on writing, speaking, and teaching about women, leadership, diversity, systems thinking, and restoring the feminine in all of us. She is the co-founder and co-facilitator of the Cultivating Women's Leadership Trainings. Nina edited the anthology Moonrise, The Power of Women Leading from the Heart, which contains 30 essays by over 40 contributors who collectively helped to redefine the leadership landscape. She suggests that leadership is now an inside job, asking of us mindfulness, an awakened heart, and a deep connection with our individual sense of purpose, assignment, or what we hold sacred. We look forward to hearing Nina. She will lead the program, but I would also like to introduce you at this time to Kenny Ausubel, whose contribution will immediately follow Nina's. Kenny Ausubel is an award-winning social entrepreneur as well. He's an author, journalist, and filmmaker. He is co-founder and CEO of Bioneers, the internationally recognized nonprofit organization that disseminates innovative solutions for restoring people and planet. He also serves as executive producer and co-writer of the award-winning international radio series, The Bioneers, Revolution from the Heart of Nature. And he contributes to the Huffington Post. He has written 4 books and edited several volumes of the Bioneers Anthology book series, Dreaming the Future, Reimagining Civilization in the Age of Nature, won the 2012 Nautilus Grand Gold Prize for Ecology-Environment. His documentary, Hoxsey, How Healing Becomes a Crime, is now a book entitled When Healing Becomes a Crime. This received the Best Censored Stories Award for Investigative Journalism and was screened for members of Congress at the Kennedy Center. Ausubel was an advisor to Leonardo DiCaprio's documentary, The 11th Hour, and appears in the film. We'll be welcoming Nina and Kenny to our platform in just a moment. But first of all, following our tradition, we would like to take 3 minutes of silence to enable us to make the transition between what we have been doing and thinking to what we will be doing and thinking once the program begins. Nina.
Well, it's so good to be here. Hard to see you, but good to be here. And can you all see me okay? I'm challenging myself to not read from notes. And I also find that I really appreciate seeing people's whole bodies instead of just from the neck up. So I thought I would practice that as well in offering my remarks to you. So that's why I'm out here. And as Dr. Lyons mentioned, we're looking forward to a conversation with you after these remarks. Kenny and I have each written things that are very specific to being among you at the Festival of Faiths. And so if there are things that ignite your curiosity or that you don't hear us talk about, that you want to know more about, or that you just want to enter into a conversation about, Sarah and Halida will be opening us into conversation after their questions, after we stop. So just please notice if things come alive in you in the course of this and hang on to them until then. I thought since we're at the Festival of Faiths, I should share something with you about my own relationship to spirituality, which really I see as the lens through which I see the world. I was raised by parents who were agnostic, although very justice-oriented. They took us to peace marches and civil rights marches very early in my childhood. And so I grew up without any formal religion and without any specific practice. And then in my 20s, I actually studied with a school for consciousness that was called Eureka. It was started by a Bolivian mystic. And it was actually a compilation of practices and exercises and teachings from really all the world's great spiritual traditions. And so I feel very fortunate to have had that. And it was a great discovery to me that I actually had a spiritual life. But even before that, what I learned as a child was that nature was where I found the sacred. It was the place that I went to, even though I grew up in New York City, I went to Central Park when I sought solace, and when I was confused, and when I really needed to find peace. And so I learned early on for myself and through my own body and my own experience that nature was a great teacher for me and a really important source of inspiration for me. And then through the course of Bioneers, over 25 years, I've had incredible teachers from all walks of life. But in particular, I've had access to a great many indigenous elders, again, from many different traditions. And they have become really important guideposts and learnings and teachers for me. And as my work has pulled me more and more into the realms of social and racial and gender justice, I've begun learning more about my Jewish ancestry and realizing that there is something for me in understanding and learning about that lineage, and realizing that for me, I believe that it comes with a particular esteem for inquiry and for having a questioning mind and for really valuing learning. And I think, as I mentioned earlier, there seems to be some correlation between an orientation towards justice and a Jewish lineage. I think, you know, two generations back, my ancestors came from Eastern Europe fleeing persecution. And so it's not that far back in my lineage that feels familiar and a part of making me who I am. So I thought I'd offer just a few observations before I sort of dive into the heart of my talk about the theme that we are gathered around, sacred self, sacred earth. Because when I saw it, I felt really affirmed and excited that it was exactly the right place for us to be. One of my guideposts for many years has been something that comes from many of the world's sacred traditions, which is the principle, as above, so below. And of course, we have one of our great examples of a spiritual teacher and activist leader in Mahatma Gandhi, who said we need to be the change we seek to affect in the world. And what I've been discovering is, as I increasingly find myself drawn towards standing on behalf of justice, that part of the work of cultivating sacred self, sacred earth, is about removing the blinders that come with privilege or with the advantages of sort of being, you know, in the benefiting side of a tilted room, of a system that always advantages others, advantages some and disadvantages others. And that one of the tricky things about that kind of a system that's based on that kind of hierarchical principle is that when you're on the benefiting side, it tends to get normalized. It often becomes invisible. And so I found, as a white woman who receives the benefits of that in our culture, that I have to very consciously sort of peel away layers of acculturated learning to be able to see through the eyes of my brothers and sisters who don't have that advantage. So I find that in my self-cultivation, that's an important part of sacred self, sacred earth. And then the other thing that I wanted to share was Bioneers has really gifted me with developing a whole systems lens, and a lens that looks for what is the inherent wholeness in a system. And one of the things that I learned very early on through Bioneers is that one of the major systems errors that we tend to make is thinking that we are apart from rather than a part of nature. And nature, of course, is an extraordinary teacher, the product of nearly 4 billion years of evolution. And we ourselves are natural systems embedded within nature, a natural system. So the same laws and rules that govern nature actually govern us. And so as I've been learning about whole systems, here are a few of the principles that I just want to mention. One is that in nature, the only constant is change. And as human beings, you know, we tend not to like change very much. We tend to resist it, we tend to avoid it, we tend to deny it. And so it's part of my practice for myself of cultivating what I call full spectrum leadership to orient myself in a positive direction towards change, to recognize that there's got to be something good in it. And we are living in a time of tremendous upheaval and change. Where there is change on every level. And so cultivating our own capacity to be flexible and adapt and respond to that, I think, is really essential. Another element of a whole system, or also known as a living system, is that we tend to be self-regulating and self-adaptive and flexible. Those are the qualities that survive. And so it makes sense to pay attention to those. Another aspect of natural systems that I've learned over and over again is that, as we've heard this morning, diversity is not something to be tolerated. Diversity is more than the spice of life. Actually, I would suggest to you that diversity is the real stuff of life, the essence of life. And that what they found when they studied ecosystems that were rich in diversity versus those that were monocultures or impoverished in diversity was that those that had many, many species in them actually adapted and rebounded after traumatic change far, far better than those that were poorer in diversity. So that means that that's true of us and of our social neighborhoods and communities and of our world. And I'll say a little more about that later. But again, I just love that inner-outer reflection that we are called to through the theme of this conference. And the last piece is that living systems are what scientists call holonic. And I learned this from Joanna Macy. Holonic is H-O-L-O-N-I-C. And what it describes is essentially the same thing as above, so below. It describes fractals. It describes the quality like those Russian dolls that nest one within the other. It essentially means that what's true for the part is true for the whole, and what's true for the whole is true for the part. And so we cycle back to as above, so below, and sacred self, sacred earth. So about full spectrum leadership for engaged action, I was so inspired by Wendell Berry, and he's been a guidepost, a teacher for me for a long time through his books. And one of the big ideas that I learned from him is an essay that he wrote called Solving for Pattern. And he suggests that there are three different kinds of solutions. You know, there are solutions that actually respond to the initial problem, but they may make everything else in the system worse. There are others that simply don't work on the initial problem, though they may have other benefits. But what he says in this essay, in essence, is that the kind of solution we want to be scanning for always is a solution that solves for pattern. And what that means is that it not only responds to the initial problem, but has cascading benefits to the whole system. And so as I thought about full spectrum leadership for engaged action, I thought I would offer three ideas or lenses that I think solve for pattern, actually, within the context of sacred self, sacred earth. So the first is about a shift from an emphasis on quantifying things to qualifying relationship. And one of my earliest mentors was the great Austrian physicist, Fritjof Capra. And Fritjof says, the shift to an eco-literate society involves a shift in focus from quantifying or counting things to mapping relationship. And that really, until we achieve that culture-wide and really shift our attention, our care, and our prioritization on relationship rather than on things, we're not going to get there. So that's the first big idea. And I'll go into each of these a little bit more. The second is this notion of the redefinition and reinvention of leadership. And I think, you know, one of the things that I've come to learn is that words are really important. And I believe, actually, in many ways, that language helps create reality. It's one of the indigenous principles that I've learned. And so I've had a real journey with leadership, with the word leadership, in my own effort to come to peace with it and right relationship with it. And so I want to talk about that. And David Orr, another one of Kentucky's great leaders and our great environmental educators, really says what we're facing is a crisis in leadership. What we need to do is actually spark leadership in everyone. This is a time when everyone's leadership is called for. And the third piece that I just want to talk about a little bit is about the power of story or narrative to change the world. And George Lakoff is a guy who many of you may have heard of. He's in the Bay Area. He calls himself a cognitive linguist. And he studies language and story and its impacts on people. And essentially what he says is that as human beings, we're hardwired for story. And what that means is that once our hearts have really wrapped themselves around a storyline, as we've done for thousands of years, no amount of facts can get us to change the story. Only a more compelling story can get us to change the story. So I would suggest to you that perhaps we're all in the business of changing the story, and that that's part of our leadership that's called for now. So about this relationship stuff, you know, in the first several years of Bioneers, I think I was a sponge. I was learning from so many extraordinary leaders and perspectives. And what I saw first off was that we are in a crisis of relationship. And we're in a crisis of relationship with ourselves, each other, and the natural world. And all three of those are really octaves of the same societal inheritance or disease or imbalance. And that spans from the personal or inner to the political and most external and systemic. Some of that relationship damage is subtle, some of it's obvious. But the challenge that I keep giving myself is to see it all. And by seeing it all, to have that inform my choice, my choices. Everything from the banal choices, but important, of, you know, which light bulbs and which toilet paper are we going to buy, to the big choices of where am I going to spend my wild and precious life? How am I going to focus my attention and my energy and my efforts? So on the inner, you know, I challenge myself, and I have for many years now, to notice, how do I perpetuate violence to myself? You know, what are some of the ways that I judge myself, or that I make myself small? I realized several years ago, when I first started this practice, for example, that I got out of the bath each morning and I glanced at myself in the mirror, and I had this little voice in my head that said, you're too blank. You know, either you haven't exercised enough, you're overweight, your body's this, your body's that. It was all those self-judgments that, as a woman, I had. And I thought, boy, that sucks. I don't want to keep doing that, right? I mean, that's a form of self-violence. And so I made up a ritual. I created a body oil, and I scented it with essential oils that I love. And each morning when I get out of the bath, I spend just a minute or two anointing my body and choosing during those 2 minutes to pour love into my body, because I need it, and it's sacred. And I need it as the instrument of my purpose and as my best way to show up in leadership to what I most love in this world. So it's an example. And you know, then on the other side, what I began to notice was, do I appreciate my successes enough? I was once in a learning circle with some young women, and one of them, we did this on the phone, and one of them said to me, you know, I've noticed that as women, we don't crow enough. And there's a very interesting article, actually, recently about self-confidence between differences between genders in The Atlantic, and I would commend it to you. But she said, you know, we don't crow enough. And we talked about that, and we realized, no, actually, growing up, we were taught not to talk about our successes. We were told not to be too full of ourselves, right? Well, who are you supposed to be full of if not yourself? So we started a practice of saying at the beginning of each call, we would say, what's happened for you in the last month that you're really proud of? Tell us about your successes, and practice appreciating what we did well. Because, you know, another of my teachers is Lynn Twist, and her book, The Soul of Money, is here. And she's a wonderful woman who also was co-founder of Pachamama, doing the Awakening the Dreamer symposium tomorrow. And she says, what we appreciate appreciates. And so how do we heal the challenges of self-confidence? If we're women, whatever gender we might be in, how do we heal? Both by stopping practicing violence against ourselves and also really appreciating what we do well. And externally, you know, the crisis in relationship, the evidence abounds all around us. I mean, from the divorce rate to an education system that has many kids coming out thinking they're not smart or not equipped for life, you know, to violence against women. I just heard on the news that 1 in 5 young women in college is being raped during the course of her college experience right now, which is just devastating. So the crisis in relationship abounds, and I would add that we're all complicit and we all suffer from it. I actually believe, the more I've studied gender justice, that our patriarchal system has damaged all of us at least equally, and perhaps it's damaged men even more than women. And that the opportunity now is to really look at it and heal from it, because the earth requires us to bring our best selves to this time. And I don't think we have time to dwell in the wounds. So in every sector, this was one of my great revelations on my own path. I began to learn, I came into this work about gender rather late in my life, and I began to understand that there is a legacy of gender imbalance that goes back hundreds of years. And that at one time in Europe, women actually had more wealth, and women were the predominant healers, and women practiced a lot of the agriculture and the resource management. And that then, during a period called the Burning Times, which was a 300 to 500 year period in European history, a great many women were tortured and persecuted and killed for the supposed crime of being witches. And there was a huge shift in all of those systems. You know, the land use went from having commons where the whole community shared the use of the land, to something called the enclosure system. The economics flipped so that where women had owned more wealth before the burning times, they owned less after the burning times. And medicine, of course, you had to go to medical school to practice medicine, and only men were allowed to practice medicine. So the system of medicine shifted as well. And I believe we all carry some scar tissue and some memory somewhere inside of us of that time. Around our house, we started calling it the hidden Holocaust of women. Because when I learned about it, I said, how can it be that we're not being taught about this in school? That every kid doesn't learn about this? This is a huge event in our collective human history. Why isn't it being taught? So, So what I learned from the burning times was that not only did all those systems shift, but that actually I believe that we have assigned certain of our human qualities and values to the masculine and the feminine. And as a result of that, we carry very insidious biases that say some are better, some are worse, some are more valuable, some are less valuable. So if we're going to cultivate ourselves as full spectrum leaders to meet this moment that the earth is asking of us, how can we cultivate our fullest capacity on a range of human qualities that ranges from masculine to feminine, so that regardless of what body we may happen to be in, we can respond in the moment from a full range of human possibilities? That's my goal, and I certainly believe that full spectrum means regardless of our temporary gender assignment, we all have masculine and feminine within us. And how do we cultivate a loving and complementary relationship between those two? Thank you. So, and lastly, about this relationship thing, I may be being a little redundant here, but diversity, understanding diversity as an advantage. Again, I think it's incumbent upon all of us to understand that our cultural norm is separation. It's what we're trained for. It's what we're seeing throughout our society and our culture. We're separated by generation. We're separated by ethnicity. We're separated by discipline. And in fact, we need the power and authority that we can aggregate by coming together across difference. And so really understanding diversity as an advantage, both within ourselves and among each other, is to me a really essential principle of how we heal this crisis of relationship. And how do we instead of accepting the cultural norm of all that divisiveness, how do we instead come to value connecting across difference as perhaps the most valuable quality that any leader can exercise? So leadership. Let's see, very quickly, here's my story. When I turned 40 about 17 years ago, I started being acknowledged for my leadership. And I found I had very conflicting reactions to it. You know, some part of me was honored and flattered, and other parts of me were like, ooh, don't put that label on me. I don't want to be called that. It's going to make me a target, and I didn't want it. And I thought, well, that's interesting. So while I'm being recognized for leadership and the world is calling for greater leadership across the boards, inwardly I have a reaction that says, I don't want this. So I needed to explore that. And what I did in order to do that was to enter into an exploration of all the leaders that I had met through Bioneers that had most inspired me. So I actually read scores, maybe even hundreds, of leadership stories, of transcripts. And as I did that, I thought, okay, what is it about these people and how are they modeling leadership that's really different than what I have been taught to expect? And how can I solve for pattern? How can I look for the patterns among all these leaders that will help me understand what this new reinvention of leadership actually looks like? And what I found was, I found that the main things, as Dr. Lyons mentioned, was that they were leading from the inside out. What motivated their leadership was their love. It wasn't because someone had given them a title or the authority or the wealth or the resources. It was because they cared so much that they basically stepped into protecting, defending, and advancing what they most loved. So their motivation was really different than I had been taught to expect leaders to be. They also were, in a very core way, they were collaborative and relational, rather than singular or heroic. You know, there's a whole school now of academics talking about post-heroic leadership. And so they were collaborative. They were leading together. And one of my colleagues actually taught me a great mnemonic for this, which I love. She said, instead of holding it together, like we often respond to stress, you know, and clenching and getting all tight and rigid, she said, we need to learn to hold it together. And so let's hold it together. And they all were. And they also really demonstrated a very diverse array of styles and positions. What I found was that some of them lead from behind, not from the front of the room, not because they're necessarily the most eloquent or the most articulate or the most aggressive. You know, some of the leaders now are leading from within the center and from the edges and from behind. And so I think we need to cultivate leadership in all its forms and recognize that it comes in as many forms as we are people. And if our human wholeness can be seen as a living system, there are four different levels or octaves that I understand as sources of intelligence. You know, there is our mind, which we're very accustomed to leading from our minds. But in addition to our minds, there is our emotions. And how do we make peace with our emotions? I mean, for a long time, we've taken a lot of crap for having emotions. And there's a wonderful book that I would commend to you called The Language of Emotions by a woman named Carla McLaren. And really, she's an empath who went into an inquiry with each of our human emotions to understand what they're there to provide us with and how important it is to understand that anger is a way for your body to tell you that a boundary has been trespassed. And in this time, when newborn babies are born with more than 200 exogenous chemicals, chemicals not found in nature, within their baby tiny bodies, if that isn't a boundary being transgressed and enough to make us all furious, I don't know what is. So there is a really appropriate place for anger, and I think we need to readopt it. And similarly, fear, you know, fear has also been vilified. It can help make us small and avoid things. But one of my teachers is a woman named Diane Wilson, who is a shrimper from the Texas Gulf Coast, a fifth-generation shrimper. And she was speaking at a Bioneers gathering one year, and she said, the way I know I'm on track is that I smell my fear, and I head straight for it. And I heard that, and I thought, what a macho load of crap. How can she say that? And then I went home, and I kept thinking about it, and I kept thinking about it, and I realized that the things that I am most fearful of talking about in public are the things that I most care about. And so, you know, I'm not advising anyone to walk into oncoming traffic or approach a dangerous animal, but fear can be a really useful guidepost. And grief and despair, you know, we are in a time of so much loss to the natural world that actually, if all of us aren't finding moments somewhere in our daily lives to acknowledge the grief and loss and despair at what's dying in the world right now, we're probably not paying attention. You know, it's why I think we have a mass epidemic of you know, medication, of people who are trying to avoid grief and despair. But what I've learned about grief and despair is that they're kind of the flip side of love, you know? And the more that I can allow myself to feel how much I care about there being elephants and whales and large mammals in the world in the future, I also recognize that there may not be and that I have a lot of grief about whales getting stomach cancer from plastic in the ocean. For some reason, it just pierces my heart when I read those stories. And if I can feel that grief, it strengthens me to stand on behalf of and with them. I'm going to hurry through here. So, full spectrum leadership. We all have different ways of processing information, right? Audio and visual and kinesthetic, and yet we have an education system that tends to focus on audio. So the kids who learn through their bodies kinesthetically come out thinking they're dumb. How do we, again, shift our world towards one that appreciates the diversity of ways we show up? Our left brain and our right, our masculine and our feminine capacities, you know, both, I think of the masculine often as discipline and focus and a sense of rigor, you know, holding myself accountable. And the feminine as compassion and nurturance and empathy. And I really want to have a balance of those things within me. So, third part, story. Hardwired for story. I found for myself, I've always loved, there's a Jewish myth, which probably there are similar myths in other faith lineages, that says that before each soul is born, we know what our purpose is, and that we know exactly why we're coming to Earth at this time, and that then through the course of being born, we forget. And if we're lucky, and we're diligent, and we pay attention, we can find our way back to understanding that assignment. And I think that's a wonderful, exciting path for myself anyway, and I would certainly invite you to explore it if it appeals to you. So what I found as I've explored the detective story of trying to find my own way to my own specific purpose is that in a way I found that I shifted from being a character in my own story who was really at the affect of everything happening around me, to becoming the central character in my own story, to eventually realizing I could actually be the author of my own story. And that there was a level of agency and of choice that that offers me that's profound and that I wish for everybody. So I want to invite you into a quick little experience that comes from a Joanna Macy exercise. Joanna Macy has a wonderful body of work and a book that's called The Work That Reconnects. And she's talking about reconnecting on all levels. And one of her exercises is called Seventh Generation. So if you're comfortable and you feel like, I'm going to invite you to close your eyes for a moment. And imagine that you are about to be visited by a time traveler from 200 years in the future. 200 years in the future, they have perfected the capacity to send somebody back, and they're sending back a young graduate student from 200 years in the future, and that graduate student is coming to interview you. Take a moment and notice if you have any assumptions, if any feelings come up, if your body has any reactions to that. Okay, so now I want to ask you, how many of you, please raise your hand if this was true for you, how many of you assumed that that person coming to interview you might be angry or disappointed or despairing? Any of you feel that? I sure did. Well, when I did that exercise, I noticed that that was my assumption. And I thought, wow, that's crazy. Because then, of course, Joanna goes on to say, they are coming back from the future because you are in their textbooks. You're a hero in their world. They want to learn from you. What did you do when the world turned upside down? How did you know how to respond? What was your personal role, and how did you navigate a time of such tremendous systemic change? And it's a very beautiful exercise. I would encourage you to try it. Apparently, not so many of you are carrying that story as were in the room at the time. What I found was that, gosh, I assumed immediately, ooh, we haven't done enough. This is gonna be a painful interview. And they're going to be either mad or hurt or upset about what we didn't do. And so I realized how important it is that we carry a story that's about the future we are co-creating. Because really, I think the world is requiring of us all to be leaders in this time. And And the last thing I wanted to leave you with was actually a poem from Bioneers, and then a quote. The poem, which my beloved partner Kenny wrote, which to me encapsulates the essence of what we're all here to talk about in Sacred Self, Sacred Earth, is, "It's all alive, it's all connected, it's all intelligent, it's all relatives." And a wonderful leader who'll be at Bioneers this year is Cecil Williams, who is actually a reverend at Glide Memorial Church in San Francisco. And one of the things that Cecil says is, it's not enough to walk the walk and talk the talk. We've got to walk the talk. So here's to being full spectrum engaged leaders, all of us, and let's walk the talk together. Thank you.
Gosh, can't see anything. Trust. So first, I'd really like to thank Festival of Faiths and Kathleen Lyons, who reached out to us initially, and Sarah Harris for all your incredibly gracious facilitation in getting us here. And Owsley, I can't see you. Yes, there you are, okay. For your extraordinary work chairing this and all the work altogether. And if Christy's here, what an extraordinary vision to carry for 19 years. And I'm so glad that you exist. So I'm very happy to be here, and we really thank you very much. So for the Festival of Faiths. And we're looking to grow a relationship, and I know some of you will be joining us at Bioneers in California in October, and I hope many of you will also come and join us. So I wrote a talk, and then I decided to not give it. what a waste of work. But I'm going to read a few parts of it that I felt were particularly germane for how and why we're here. But I'd like to do sort of a hybrid of just talk with you a little bit, tell some stories, and then read some parts that I think are worth hearing, things that I've learned over the years. And you know, what I would say at the beginning too is that one last acknowledgement, which is that we have a Bioneers chapter here in Louisville. Yeah. Bluegrass Bioneers. So we're very grateful for keeping the faith, the Bioneers faith here in Louisville. So thank you. And I hope everybody here gets to participate in that as well. So Snail is trucking through Snailville, you know, minding his own business. And along comes Turtle and runs right over him. And finally, the Snail police arrive, right? Bit of a delay there. And they say, What happened? And Snail says, "I don't know, it all happened so fast." So, you know, we didn't get here overnight. This wasn't a summer romance. This is really the end game of a civilization on a collision course with nature and each other. And basically, you know, to put it, I know everybody here wants to hear all the positive stuff. So that's what Bioneers is about. So that's easy. But I do want to acknowledge a couple things that were said here over the last few days. And you know, in cultural terms, basically we've been acting like a rock star trashing a hotel room, and it's the morning after. Only this hotel is planet Earth, and the guest rules are non-negotiable. And if we don't change our ways really fast, we're going to get voted off the island. So, I mean, that's the short version. And also, we really did pass a very significant threshold last year of 400 parts per million of CO2. In the atmosphere. This is the last time this was the case was 3 million years ago, long before Homo sapiens existed. Earth was a hothouse. Camels roamed the Arctic, and the sea levels were 50 to 80 feet higher. So this is the big gulp. This is beyond being a disaster. I mean, this is heading for complete catastrophe. And you know, the solutions are largely present. That's what we're going to talk about with Bioneers, and we'll get into more of it in conversation after this. But you know, whatever people said the last few days, it's even worse, I have to be honest with you. It's that serious. And the next 5 or 6 years, I believe, and many of the wisest people that I know believe, are really kind of the do or die moment here to cause a major global shift, to redirect. And if we can redirect the ship, we could at least avoid complete climate chaos and the many other interconnections that go with that. I'm actually more optimistic than I've been in a long time, because I think what we're witnessing is a kind of a global movement of movements that's been growing incrementally for quite some time now. It's a real convergence, and I think that whatever is going on, there are other forces at work, that there's simply a zeitgeist right now, a kind of, you know, an idea whose time has come. And some sense, probably intuitively, that we all feel around survival, that things really, really do have to change. It's a time of momentous breakdown and breakthrough. So in many ways, I am actually extremely hopeful. And at the same time, I think we need to be extremely sober and recognize this is it. You know, it's showtime, and we all need to really show up. The other thing that wasn't mentioned that I think is really important to say is that there's another really big thing going on right now. And yes, you know, on one level, we're all complicit in different ways in this, and really, we're also really not. Globalization has pushed wealth upwards into a concentration that is unparalleled in all of human history. Inequality in the US today is, the concentration of wealth, rather, is twice what it was in Imperial Rome, which was a slave and farmer society, okay? According to the CIA, the US is more unequal than Egypt and Tunisia at this point, right? And as they say, the 400 wealthiest people in this country now have more than the, quote, bottom 185 million. I mean, a bottom, that's more than half the population. So, and that's, you know, the wealthiest country on earth right now. So this is very serious, and it's basically a very small handful of fossil fuel billionaires who have captured our political systems and our government policies. And it's not that the public kind of gets it, actually, and 75% of the American public, according to polls, believe that big business has too much power in this country. So let's not kid ourselves, we're not in control. And that's one of the topics I want to get to a little bit, is what we do about the rhinoceros in the room, which is corporate power. And I also want to distinguish, because within the 0.01%, there are also many really wonderful people who are, in fact, who, you know, need to be with us, and we need to be with them. And I think that that is also beginning to occur, you know, and anyway, don't get me started about that, but so. And the one other thing I want to say on that same topic is that I heard, you know, a number of people say we're the 100%, and there's, again, there's truth to that, and there's also exceptions. And I don't know if any of you might have read Robert Hare's book about psychopaths, but the core definition of a psychopath is a complete lack of empathy and an utter lack of remorse, right? It's somebody who has been stripped of what we would all probably consider to be your most basic humanity. They're also often extreme narcissists. And Robert Hare has a wonderful psychopathy checklist. And if you go down that, it actually looks like sort of a job description for a CEO. In many cases. And I think we also need to be realistic that there are people who are severely damaged goods. And you know, there really ought to be a 12-step recovery program or something like that for these people. And you know, but it really is criminal behavior. And I think we also need to be cognizant of that. So a lot of the premise for starting Bioneers in 1990 was really that the solutions are largely present, or we know what directions to head in. And that's even more true today. And I kind of fell into this, so during the 70s and 80s, like many people at that time, I became acutely aware of what was a looming environmental crisis. And what I wanted to know is, okay, I don't really want to sit here shivering in the dark in fear. What do we do about it? You know, has anybody out there figured anything out? And one by one, I just started to kind of poke around, and I was a journalist, and I'm just an interested person, whatever. And one by one, I began to find these really remarkable individuals who had come up with really serious systemic solutions to major environmental crises. And the first characteristic, I looked for patterns, or the patterns looked for me, one or the other, excuse me, was that they were all systems thinkers. it's all connected. It's one of the most basic precepts in life. And so you can't, you have to solve the whole problem. You can't silo these things. And, you know, we created initially what we called a declaration of interdependence, right? And it's very simple to understand. Taking care of nature means taking care of people, and taking care of people means taking care of nature. That's all that we really need to know on one level. The other characteristic was all of these people had looked to nature, not as a physical resource, but as a teacher, mentor, and model. You know, we don't really want the cake, we want the recipe. You know, that's what it boils down to. And that later became very much the inspiration for Bioneer as a field that didn't have a name in 1990. Janine Benyus gave it a name about 8 years later called biomimicry, the idea of imitating nature. And the word bio, bios, is the Greek word, means life. It's really the study of life, natural life. So I wanted to share a couple of things in that regard, a few things that I'd like to read that I think are worth thinking about from a cosmological perspective, and then I'd like to talk a little bit about biomimicry. So Chief Oren Lyon, some of you may know, we had hoped to actually help bring him here this year, but he was already committed somewhere else, but I hope you'll get him in the future. He's an Iroquois elder and faith keeper and a kind of a global citizen diplomat, also has a great sense of humor. So Oren asked a question at Bioneers a couple years ago. It's the pressing question, I think, for all of us. How do you teach 7 billion people to respect their relationship with the Earth soon, now? So he posed that question, why? Because we're facing a crisis, he said. And he went on to tell this story in the context of the 2012 end of the Mayan calendar. This was a couple years ago. So he said, we have good relations with the Maya. We've known them for a long time. So I asked one of their leaders, well, what's happening in 2012? And he said, calendar's coming to an end. I asked, then what? He said, well, we'll make another one. However, he added, there'll be a period of enlightenment. And Oren continued his story. He said, I've been talking to some friends in Long Island, and I thought about that. Here's this businessman who works in New York, and it's a beautiful day. So he decides he's going to take his boat, go out and do some fishing, instead of go to work. He's way out in Montauk, tip of Long Island, sitting out there fishing. Bright sun, hot day, so he jumps off the boat and swims around. Pretty big boat, and you need a ladder to get back up. The ladder's there, he's floating around in the water, beautiful. He drifts a little ways from the boat, but not far. He turns around and he sees a gray fin coming directly at him, about 3 feet out of the water. Oh crap, he says, should have went to work. That's a period of enlightenment. And one of our, you know, friends who comes to Bioneers who speaks is actually Iroquois Six Nations from Canada, Oki Simony Forest, but she has been living and working in Chiapas with the Mayan people for about the last 30 plus years. And we had the chance to sit down with her, and she told me some of the Mayan cosmology about this time and this moment that we're in right now. And I'd like to share some of her words about that. The Mayan people call this moment the time of no time. From here on, we're on Earth time. Mother Earth is shaking to her core. It's a time of madness, disconnection, and hyper-individualism. It's also a time when new energies are coming into the world, when people are growing a new skin. The Mayan vision says we in the West will find safe harbor only if we can journey past a wall of mirrors. The mirrors will drive us mad, unless we have a strong heart. Some mirrors delude us with an infinity of reflections of our vanity and shadows. Others paralyze us with terror and rage, feeding an empire that manufactures our fear into resignation. But the empire has no roots and it's toppling all around us. In this time, everyone is called to take a stand. Everyone is called to be a leader. To get beyond the wall of mirrors, the final challenge is to pass through a tiny door. To do this, we must make ourselves very, very small, to be very humble. Then we must burrow down into the earth where indigenous consciousness lives. On the other side is a clear pond. There, for the first time, we'll be able to see our true reflection. In this time of no time, we can go in any direction we want by dreaming it. Our dreaming can shift the course of the world. And paradoxically, this moment that we're facing now, this crisis, is exactly the dream of our current civilization. The dream of endless growth, materialism, hyper-individualism, and domination has turned into a nightmare. So how do we dream our way out of that nightmare? Well, one way is to wake up. You know, and that's exactly what's happening all over the world, and people are awakening, I think, to a new dream. So what I'd like to do is to share with you just a little bit about biomimicry in that context and another perspective on that. So when I was beginning to learn about these people out there with these fundamental solutions, they really were looking to nature as a teacher, mentor, and model. And essentially in 3.8 billion years, nature has done everything that we want to do, but without mining the past or mortgaging the future, right? And the solutions are elegant, they're simple. Nature doesn't gulp energy, it sips it. There's a lot of research that's been done on this now, but nature solves 95% of problems through structural innovations, structural approaches, and organizational ones. Very seldom does nature use a lot of energy. Our technologies, only about 12% of our technologies actually use organization and structure as principles. So here, try this on. The journal Science reported in 2005 that the giant earthquake, the one that caused the Asian tsunami and ruptured more than 800 miles of seafloor in the Indian Ocean, also set off a series of tremblors felt nearly 7,000 miles away in Alaska. 1 hour after the quake, Mount Wrangell recorded 14 small earthquakes in 11 minutes. Said Michael West of the Alaska Volcano Observatory, it was pulsing, if you will, in sync with the waves from Sumatra. In fact, the earthquake's massive shockwaves ricocheted around the world, raising the Earth's rocky crust by half an inch. For weeks, the planet vibrated like a bell. Commented West, we're learning that the Earth is a far more connected place than we once thought it was. Naturalist and author biomimicry expert Janine Benyus investigated what happened in Thailand before the tsunami. Elephants started trumpeting. Lizards, insects, and snakes started climbing up into trees. The flamingos that were breeding near there had already gone inland. They were shocked to find no animal corpses besides humans. The animals had moved inland, they'd moved up. Pacinian corpuscles are mechanoreceptors in the tip of an elephant's trunk and its feet that are also found in human skin. They sense what are called Raleigh waves that move in and through the earth. They were started by the rupture in the earth. These Raleigh waves move in the surface of the earth about 10 times faster than the speed of sound. Elephants pick up infrasound. The animals talk to one another with infrasound, very low tones through the air. Their infrasound, we now think, causes Raleigh waves in the earth so that their messages can go even farther, so that an elephant can say, I'm ovulating, come home. An hour before the elephants started to wail, and before the first waves hit, elephants who were toting tourists around broke their chains and ran inland. We, of course, ran toward the sea. We're a young species with a lot to learn. We see through a glass darkly, and when you do that, you should probably borrow some lenses from the organisms that can see much better. So we're really tuned in these days to survivors. So what if it's all connected? That question arose in the 1960s for scientific researcher James Lovelock. After NASA asked him to design experiments for the Viking space mission to determine if there was ever life on Mars, he began to ponder what makes life different from non-life. Outer space brought him back down to Earth. Lovelock was intrigued that Earth's atmosphere had remained relatively constant over long periods of time. Just a small increase or decrease in the amount of oxygen would either set the atmosphere on fire or kill most life forms. Why has the ratio of oxygen remained at just the right level? Why have the oceans maintained just the right salt concentration favorable to life? How has the temperature range that life depends on managed to remain relatively constant? Lovelock's bold hypothesis was that somehow the sum total of living things on Earth has modulated the balance of oxygen and carbon dioxide, the saltiness of the sea, the surface temperature of the planet, just as our bodies know how to regulate themselves. With microbiologist Lynn Margulis, Lovelock proposed the Gaia hypothesis, the idea that the entire symphony of life of all living things self-regulates the Earth's conditions to make the physical environment more hospitable for them in an exquisite dynamic balance. Think of it as a vast hospitality enterprise. Or, in the words of Janine Benyus, what life does is to create conditions conducive to life. So if there's a single mission statement, you know, that's probably it. So really what we're entering now is the age of nature. You know, the saying is, you know, we didn't invent nature, nature invented us. They say that nature bats last, but even more importantly, it's her playing field. So we would be wise to learn the ground rules and how to play by them. And we're surrounded by genius, surrounded by elders. So just to give you one example, so there was a bullet train, how this is practically being applied right now in Japan. A bullet train went through very, very crowded neighborhoods, and it would go through tunnels, right, where because of the difference in air pressure going into a tunnel, it would cause these horrendous sonic booms, right? And you can imagine entire neighborhoods feeling like they're being bombed constantly several times a day. So one of their board members from the bullet train was a birder. And he wondered who in nature, you know, would be dealing with this kind of differential in pressure. So he looked to the kingfisher bird, which dives straight down into the water at very, very high speed to go fishing, right? Yet it barely makes a ripple when it goes into the water. So they redesigned the front of the bullet train like the beak of a kingfisher. No more sonic booms. I mean, that's just to give, you know, one example. Velcro is the first sort of well-known biomimicry invention. It's like from a burr that will grip onto something, right? One of our favorite biomimics is Jay Harman. He's an Australian inventor who grew up by the ocean in Australia and became fascinated with actually what turned out to be nature's favorite form, which is the spiral, right? And the spiral is pervasive from how the blood flows through your vein to how water goes down a drain to the shape of hurricanes to the shape of galaxies to how air moves through your lungs. Yet it's never been applied in design. It's been a fascination, a long lineage of everybody from Leonardo da Vinci to Descartes to, you know, on and on. It's the golden mean. It's the Fibonacci sequence that's a representation of aesthetic beauty and infinity. It's the sort of perfection of aesthetic, you know, design. So Jay began to apply these spirals first to boats and then to propellers. And we don't think about it, but motors in the world use about 60% of the world's electricity, yet they're horrendously wasteful. And so he looked at propellers and motors by applying a spiral design and saves massive quantities of energy. If you see a propeller in the water, it creates a tangle of, you know, disturbed energy. When you look at his impeller, which is this a spiral so beautiful that it's actually in the Museum of Modern Art in New York as artwork, this gorgeous little spiral impeller, it creates virtually no disturbance whatsoever and saves about 70% of the energy that you would otherwise be using. Huge energy saver. So Jay applied this to water treatment a few years ago. You've probably seen in cities the very large 2 million gallon water storage tanks, right? Well, they have a tremendous problem with those. In fact, they have to have two of them because what happens is there's heat stratification that occurs in the water, which breeds bacteria. So then they have to pump in tremendous amounts of chemicals as well as move it from one to the other to try to get some motion into it stop the bacteria from growing. So Jay put one tiny little impeller that uses the power of about 3 light bulbs in the bottom of this thing. It creates a spiral vortex, just that vibration in the water. And they now have to use, they don't have to transfer the water between tanks, and they use virtually no chemicals at all because of that simple design. Now, just to give you a sense of the bleeding edges of this, Jay says that climate change right now, essentially the greenhouse effect, is almost identical to the stratification of heat that you find in these giant water tanks. So he's now working with a very large city in China, about 200,000 people, where they're using this for air pollution to create a spiral vortex in the air that he says, if you did this on a slightly larger scale, could actually buy us 20 years away from climate disruption by essentially blending the atmosphere. I mean, anything of that nature, you know, and we will see geoengineering schemes coming up soon. I mean, things are now out front enough about what's going on that we're going to see really crazy stuff start to come out. The same mentality that created the problem is going to now create further problems. So anything like this is always very, you want to have a lot of precaution in what you do. But if you're going to try anything in that realm, this would be what you would want to do. In a slightly different realm, talking about, we hear about biotechnology. Most of these are not biotechnologies. They're still highly mechanical technologies. But a true biotechnology is our very good friend, Paul Stamets, who's a mycologist who'll be at Bioneers again this year. I think we first met Paul around 1996 or 97. And you will never know how absolutely fascinating mushrooms and fungi are until you meet Paul Stamets. But Paul knew, of course, that there were tremendous health benefits to various mushrooms. In fact, one of the mushrooms that he collected from the Pacific Northwest rainforest where he lives, the turkey tail, is now moving through NIH as a cancer cure for breast cancer. He gave it to his mother, who had stage 4 breast cancer, I think in her 70s, and she has had a complete recovery doing nothing but that. So Paul asked the basic question, well, if these are such powerful medicines in our bodies, what role do they play, you know, as a healing agent for Earth, for the land? And long story short, there was a huge spill of diesel fuel near his little farm up in Washington State. They brought in all the bioremediation companies to have at it. They gave them each a cell of dirt about 20 feet square, contaminated with diesel fuel. I mean, overwhelming stench from all of this, and said, have at it. So all the kind of more standard, you know, heat, beat, and treat companies came in with different types of technologies. And what Paul did is he inoculated the pile with the spore from oyster mushrooms that you would buy and eat, you know, with gourmet mushrooms from the store. They all came back about 6 weeks later, and one by one, they're ripping the tarps off these things, and the stench of hydrocarbons is overwhelming. If they were working at all, it was very, very slow. And then they get to Paul's, right? And they rip the tarp off, and it is blanketed with oyster mushrooms, some of them 2 feet in diameter. They tested the flesh of the mushrooms. They tested the soil, essentially no trace whatsoever of diesel left. This is a basic Bioneer principle. In nature, there is no waste. Everything is somebody's lunch of either food or energy. You just have to know which organisms to mix and match, right? But that's only the beginning. The story gets even better. So what then happened was the mushrooms started to decay. Worms and maggots came in to eat the mushrooms. Birds came in to eat the worms. The birds brought seeds on their feathers, and within a matter of weeks, this dead, contaminated dirt turned into an oasis of fertility, right? Now, oil is the basis for, you know, the entire economy, basically, but chemicals, agriculture, I mean, the implications of this for rapidly remediating degraded farmlands, you know, from synthetic chemicals is overwhelming. And you don't actually need an engineer, you need a gardener, right? I mean, this is something that we talk about citizen science. This could be done globally, and it's unlike a Superfund site, it doesn't take hundreds of millions or billions of dollars. It takes very little money and mostly some people power and some knowledge. So this is the kind of thing that needs to scale. You know, when we say that the solutions are present, this is serious stuff. And the real issue is, how do we move this stuff to scale very, very quickly? And that's a lot of what our focus is with Bioneers right now. How am I doing on time, Nina? Are you tracking a little bit? Yeah, I'm going to run out of time. I had so much more. So let me just give you a couple of other things then. One thing, McKinsey and Company, whom probably some of you have heard of, a global management and business consulting firm, very mainstream, very respected in those worlds, has written a report about a year and a half ago that 2015 is the year when distributed solar energy is going to tip. And what's been developing over time, for a variety of reasons, is, you know, we have this, obviously electric utilities are some of the worst CO2 polluters. And without changing that, we're not going to get very far. However, their business model is completely archaic. They're these highly centralized, fossil fuel dependent systems and investor owned. The wealth flows upwards. So because of, in part, China and how cheap solar panels are now, solar energy is truly competitive financially and can be distributed at the at the rooftop level and at the community level very, very widely. There's a great new company called Mosaic that you can check out that has come up with an innovation which is financial, not technological. The technology is all there. What they're doing is doing project by project that you can crowdfund it, where regular people from $25 and up can say, we could say right here in Louisville, you want to do a large community center or take an entire neighborhood and go solar with community generation, get off the grid. You can invest in that project. You don't get equity. You get a guaranteed 4.5% return over a 2-year period. And you are personally helping to move distributed energy widely. So this whole thing is predicted to tip next year. Very likely it will. It's truly revolutionary in that regard. The utility industry is quaking in its boots. They are now trying to impose taxes on you if you have solar panels on your house that you're going to be charged for using their power lines, right? Whereas now you actually get money back if you can put money into the grid. So that's just one other example. Another one is that, let's talk about corporations a little bit and other game changers. So a fellow named Tom Lindsay has a group called the Community Environmental Legal Defense Fund. And Tom is one of, I think, only 200 public interest attorneys in the whole country anymore. I mean, this used to be a large field and it has really, dwindled. And he was representing, local governments and citizens who were experiencing environmental harms of different types, usually poorer communities because they're the most vulnerable always. And he couldn't keep up with the demand. There was such an overwhelming need for his services. So what he did is he started to train citizen lawyers and they began to win the cases. But then what happened was it would move up the political food chain and it would get to a policy board or a governor and they would just shut it down and just basically change the rules of engagement and say, sorry, we're approving this pipeline or this factory farm or whatever and you can't object. And what Tom discovered is we have a constitution that's fundamentally a property rights constitution, which creates many, many contradictions. And as you probably have followed with Citizens United and other court cases, corporations have somehow gained this thing called personhood, that they are a human being, which is obviously completely absurd. I mean, they don't die for starters. they're sort of clearly, if they're immortal, there couldn't be a human being. But in any case, what they discovered was that really what they needed to do in order for this to work was to revoke corporate personhood at the local level. And so this was a community in Western Pennsylvania initially where they were moving in huge factory farming en masse. I mean, like mega companies moving in. It's an area with a lot of traditional farms and a many hundred year tradition of family and small farms. So people did not want this. It was clear it was going to destroy the landscape, destroy the economy, because farmers were already under pressure, and this was going to essentially make them serfs, working on these impossible contracts that gave them all the liability, basically. And so what they ended up doing was simply revoking corporate personhood and corporate constitutional rights at the local level and banning factory farming. And this went up all the way through the political food chain in Pennsylvania, and they finally actually won. There's now 400 communities in the US that have done this. But what evolved in the course of this was that, and this came from the people, not from Tom, was that people said, it's not just a matter of us wanting to have the right of self-determination in our community. What about nature? And what became clear is nature has no rights because we have a property rights constitution, right? So bears, rivers, ecosystems, they have no rights at all. They're just considered property. Anybody can do whatever they want. So what's wrong with this picture? When we talk about creation, what does that really mean? So what they did is they mimicked work coming out of originally from South Africa to give nature rights. 142 communities have now done this. And as a person, you can stand as a trustee on behalf of nature and say, you can't do that to the river because the river has a right to exist, persist, and flourish. And through a daisy chain of connections that originated with Bioneers, it landed, and through Lynn Twist and Pachamama Alliance, it landed all the way in Ecuador, where it is now in the national constitution of Ecuador. Enforcing it is a whole other matter, but it exists. I mean, these are the game changers. So, I just give you a glimmer of that. So I didn't get to half of what I wanted to, but I'd like to just close with one thing from our good friend, Andy Lipkus, who runs a group called Tree People. Is anybody familiar with Tree People in Los Angeles? Okay. So they're pulsing. You know, if we have time, we can talk more about some of these. But, in this time of no time, the Mayan time of no time, what we need to get past the wall of mirrors is a strong heart. And this is how Andy Lipkus puts it. I believe that every single one of us has a scanner on board that's operating in our body that nature must have installed. It's our heart. It's asking the question, where am I needed? How can I help? When something hits your frequency, my frequency, it converts to adrenaline, a biochemical response. It might be a drip, it might be a shot. When we're given a shot of adrenaline, like when we see a car accident, it gives us the power to go help lift a car off the injured person. It looks like a miracle, but it's nature's gift to us. When the ecosystem is hurting, we get the drip. We're hardwired for this. The love that's there can sustain us. It's what really feeds us. I've come to believe that nature has adapted us to be its healers. It's raised us from being infants that were helpless to being brilliant, powerful, compassionate beings. We've got to take care of the mom, Earth, because she's given us everything to raise us to this point, not so we can kill ourselves. Where am I needed? How can I help? Your heart will answer. You're big enough. We can do this. No one before has ever faced what we face today. We make the road by walking. So it's an honor to walk this road with you and keep the faith. Thank you.
A good time for everybody to stand up and get the kinks out of your knees for a minute or two, and then we'll it's going to be so hard to know where to start. I'm tempted to say, what are the pieces you didn't get to?
There's a couple I just really wish I could share.
Can we give you a little break and start with Nina?
Sure, whatever you like.
Let's each pose a question to Nina, and then we can try Kenny, and then we'll open up the floor to pent-up questions that I can just feel are in the audience. I was struck by the crisis of relationship comment that you made, and it is the crux of the theme that we are exploring here. And I personally think that my shrimp boating feeling is that we tend not to lean into conflict in our society. And I think the result is that it isolates us. But relationship is really formed by going through the conflict. And I was wondering if conflict has been any part of your discovery of leadership and adaptability, and just wondered if you could talk about your experience with conflict.
Sure, happy to. You want to give me yours too?
No, let's start with that.
Okay. Well, yeah. I think an aversion to conflict has been a really important part of my own learning, and it's. We actually do quite a bit of work in our women's leadership retreats around something that we adapt from a Rockwood leadership training called difficult conversations. And it's really about the practice of how do we prepare ourselves to go into a difficult conversation and bring our full selves to bear there, because our tendency is to leave parts of ourselves behind, perhaps as self-protection, perhaps out of fear, you know, for a number of reasons. Mm-hmm. And one of my favorite reference points around exactly what you're asking in conflict is a teacher of mine once said that relationships are the product of rupture and repair. And I find that really useful to remember, because when you're facing a rupture, it feels like the end of the world. And the truth is that when we address the ruptures and choose to head into it with an intention of repair, that's when our relationships get intimate and deeper.
Beautiful. So,
yeah.
Well, I first of all want to start by saying thank you to both of you for being here. And we've talked, Sarah and I have talked about how about the connection between your organization, the Bioneers, and the work of the Center for Interfaith Relations and the collaboration that is possible there. So it's exciting that we're launching it here at Sacred Earth, Sacred Self. And so much of what you said really resonated personally with me. I have a good friend who told me every day I should do something that scares me. So when you were talking about fear, that really, it just kind of came to the forefront of my mind. But I want to go back again on the relationships and this concept of being collaborative and leading together rather than singular, being singular and heroic. Can you expand on that a little bit more and maybe bring in some of the work that you do in, with your women in leadership and then through Bioneers, how you reach out into the communities to build collaborative relationships?
That's a hard question. Okay, I'll try. Yipes. Well, in a way, you know, the first thing that comes to mind that I want to say is that for me, one of the scariest things that I've headed into in the last few years has been a really deep exploration of how to be a better ally to people who live in very different circumstances and communities and different backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And so, because I guess what I want to say first is that, you know, partnership and collaboration is like a nice lofty goal, and the practice is hard. Mm-hmm. And sometimes what I've found is I have a desire for partnership and it's not well matched. Mm-hmm. And so I have to be really careful about whether my heart's leading me correctly in that or not, and be willing to weigh the evidence as things are revealing. But what occurred to me that I wanted to say was that one of the experiences that I've had now several times is having a knowledge of an injustice move from my head to my heart. Mm-hmm. And the specific example I thought I'd offer is that a young Lakota woman came and took our training. And what typically happens for me is that I kind of fall in love with every one of the 20 women who are there in the training. And it's just part of my nature. And I, as I see them and I see who they're becoming, I'm just smitten. So, but this woman in particular really blew me away. And she was a mother of two and a very powerful leader and a cancer survivor and just a beautiful young woman. And we became quite close during the course of the retreat. And afterwards, I actually ran into her father and heard that she was in some despair. And I called her. And she told me that she had just learned that her two nieces had been raped. And they were like age 10 and 13. And I spent about an hour and a half on the phone with her. And what I realized as I listened to her just vent about her sense of powerlessness and how much she loved these two young women was that I had read books and articles and known about the high incidence of domestic violence and rape and abuse of women in Native country, but I had known about it from the distance that my privilege afforded me. Mm-hmm. And as I heard this woman, my heart just cracked open and I was like,
I am going to stand with you no matter what. I don't know what I can bring to this, but I know I'm going to have to bring something. Mm-hmm. And so at the moment, it's storytelling and bringing her into a network that I'm forming. But it's an example anyway of where I really felt called to create an alliance across lots of gaps of difference. And it's a really hard question because it's not easy. Right. And I, you know, my sense is that, you know, in an intellectual way, it's really helpful to map out what do we have and what do we need and how can we benefit each other. Mm-hmm. But then there's something about chemistry and mystery that happens. Mm-hmm. And to leave room for that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for asking.
I'm so present in the answer to that question, but I was reading your book, Dreaming the Future, and was it Bill McKibbins who said that it's the manual on how to get from despair to action. And I'm a mother of three daughters, and one's graduating from high school next week, and another, a 10th grader and a 5th grader. And it occurs to me that their education, although it's been a very fine one, has not had the eco-literacy that you reference in the book. And I'm wondering if you were to advise the school systems in Kentucky or in Louisville on what modifications need to be made to curriculum today, not only in the eco-literacy area, but in the resiliency skills that you address in a community. What would you advise our school systems?
Hmm. Well, not my expertise, just to be clear, but okay. that never stopped me before. You know, the school system is incredibly important for obvious reasons, but for other reasons as well, which is we talk about with Bioneers turning education into action. And the reality, the metric that we're actually using for the organization now, it's not ROI, return on investment, it's ROE, return on engagement. And so schools are in a very unique position in their communities to become partners in restoration. We have work to do. We have very real work. It's not just about book learning or sitting in a classroom. And one of the big innovations that's happened, particularly already in school systems, is really around food, where kids grow gardens. And actually, the turnkey or the tipping point that happens is not so much the growing the food, but actually preparing it. Mm-hmm. Cooking seems to be the transformative act for young people. So that has, you know, food is the biggest pathway we all eat. It's the single biggest, you know, entry point for most people into an understanding of what we call the environment of nature and our interaction with it. So I think that's a good stepping stone, and you can do watershed restoration. You can do everything that was talked about this morning in terms of social justice and equality issues, of becoming really aware of the disparities, you know, which are, you know, a society that wastes its environment, wastes its people. It's real easy to understand. It's the same deal all the way around. So I think that building those bridges and actually engaging institutions, and when you go to higher education, one of our board members is David W. Orr, who has been at Oberlin for many years and has done an extraordinary project there called the Oberlin Project, where the university has, the college has partnered with the community of Oberlin. They're going carbon neutral by 2020. They're engaging the entire student body to do this as a partner with the community, not as the ivory tower at all. They've just raised $33 million to do a green downtown redevelopment that includes an arts and culture center, precisely to bring forth this kind of education. And, you know, they've got a 70,000 acre green belt around the whole city that is enough to produce food for the entire region there, right? Locally, right on hand, organically. So I think that's the really big opportunity with the school system now is education for action. And, you know, many kids, as Nina was talking, there's many different ways of learning, and certain people who are auditorially oriented do well in the current school situation. Kids who are kinesthetic and need to do stuff to learn, which is frankly most kids too, especially boys. Mm-hmm. That you know, so I think that there's so many ways to come at it right now, but the reality is we all need to be focused on the sheer scale of work that needs to be done. This is not something we can just study for a bunch more years. We have to act now. That's what I would say. Good.
Okay, so Kenny, you mentioned when you were talking, when you came to found, the two of you, the Bioneers, there was a looming environmental crisis. It was 1990. Here we are in your 25th year, and the crisis isn't looming anymore. But the whole mission of your organization has been about hope and about identifying solutions and a positive way forward. And personally, that's important to me. And I don't think we understand the science. I agree that the crisis is here, it's upon us, but I'm not sure that we're gonna find our way out if we worry about the end of the world. So I appreciate the organization is bringing hope to the equation. And I just wonder if you can reflect on 25 years later and perhaps provide some local examples of that hope and that success and the change that you think has happened.
Sure. David Orr, again, one of my favorite quotes from him is, hope is a verb with its sleeves rolled up, right? So that's the kind of hope I can relate to, not some abstract, gee, yeah, let's hope it all changes. You know, I think it's a verb. I went back, memory can be a real shapeshifter, right? You know, yeah. And so I went back to all of the archives and files at the origin of Bioneers and read through everything from beginning to end, to try to get a real documentary sense of what actually happened and how it evolved. And the most interesting thing I found was from Time magazine from 1988, late 1988, the Person of the Year issue, which I had in my folders. And it was actually, they made Endangered Earth the Person of the Year. It was the Planet of the Year. It was a beautiful Christo sculpture that was basically the Earth being shellacked and bound up. And what had happened was Jim Hansen had just testified before Congress for the first time as the Paul Revere of global warming in 1988. My brother Jesse had been working on this since 1976 at the National Academy of Sciences, so I knew some of that. But Hansen said, hey, we've got the decade of the 90s to dodge the bullet here. We can still avert this. And Time magazine had done this highly intelligent issue, uncharacteristically, really looking at solutions, and some of it was pretty dumb, but a lot of it was, at least they were really talking about the important stuff, all the kinds of issues that we would all be talking about today. And so I think, I didn't really remember this, but ironically at that moment there was huge hope. I mean, there was the sense that, wow, this is reaching the highest levels. They had just convened a conference in Colorado with all these major players, from companies, from everything. And there was a real awareness, and Hansen basically hoped to provoke a national reaction, and he did. But it came from Exxon and Mobil and the fossil fuel industry, who conducted the most successful disinformation campaign in history. It was a catastrophic success that sowed denial, doubt, and delay. I mean, delay above all. They knew exactly what they were doing. It was psychopathic behavior, as we like to say. And so, 10 years into it, we were sort of reframing, and what I would say now is that it's been stunning to see the growth of this movement of movements that we are a part of and that we've helped to hopefully shape and influence a little bit, or at least to connect people across all these different areas. And the solutions are absolutely present, except some of the problems have turned into predicaments, for which a problem has a clear solution. A predicament, there is no solution. All you can do is respond, adapt, like climate disruption. I mean, there isn't a solution for that now. We're in it, you know, we've roused the cobra. So I think that's the biggest difference. But our theme this year, which we don't usually do, but it's growing the movement, the world we want, and how to get there. And looking back, what I realize is it is unbelievable how much knowledge, skill, and actually really serious, I know people who can say these are the five game changers in the field of eco-design, or we talk about the rights of nature and revoking corporate rights. Those are game changers. Mm-hmm. I mean, if we managed to do that at the whole, you talked about solving for pattern. So we decided to talk not just with our speakers about that, but to put it out to the entire Bioneers community. All of you are invited to respond. We're going to start promoting this imminently, and we're going to start to gather the collective knowledge that is widely shared to really kind of lay out a trellis for the next 5-6 years. And you know, if you're not currently engaged and you want to get engaged, here's, you know, whether it's food systems or education or eco-design or social justice or racial, these are, you know, the game-changing, here's some pathways you can pursue. And, you know, a lot of times people ask me, well, okay, I get it, you know, what do I do? And, man, I have had, my life is so filled with left turns, you know, I don't even know what I'm doing half the time. I don't like to tell other people what to do. You know, I'm very skittish about that. So, you know, all I can say is it's great that you're asking that question. That's the first step. You know, that's the entry point. And follow your heart, follow your passions and your interests, meet the people, go out and learn and connect and find the people that you want to play and work with. And, you know, your path will reveal.
Perhaps we should hear from our audience.
And open it up. Over this way.
Thank you both for a wonderful talk. As a boy in the 1960s, I had the obligatory picture book of dinosaurs, and the last chapter was about the death of the dinosaurs, the end of the era of dinosaurs, and they had lovely picture of dinosaurs towering overhead, the greenery, and down in the underbrush are these little proto-mammals. And they made the point that there were these little critters that basically the descendants of whom became the next set of species that dominated the Earth. And in your 25 years of Bioneers, you've been exposed to hundreds, thousands of amazing, innovative ideas. I'm wondering what your it's pretty easy for us all to identify what the dinosaurs are in our scenario, the fossil fuel industries that you were just speaking of, Kenny, and so on, the economic system, some of the political pathologies that we have. What do you think might be some of the proto-mammals lurking in the underbrush now that might end up being the dominant species after the dinosaurs die?
Well, or what I'm hearing you ask, let me ask if this is correct. Are there strategies that seem like they're really sort of keystone, right? I think actually that we are in this moment of reinventing everything about how we live on Earth and with each other. So in a sense, I would say, you know, it's all up for reinvention, which is the good news and the bad news. But given that, I think that there are policy innovations. I think that embedding the rights of nature is an extraordinary thing. And actually, the city of Spokane is on the verge of actually achieving that. So, you know, you asked something about the local innovations. There are cities that, working with their local Bioneers community, have identified strategies that they're actually implementing, whether it's community gardens, whether it's social or racial justice oriented, or whether it's embedding a policy. So I think that's an example of something. I think that what was mentioned here this morning around urban gardens and food sovereignty and developing a whole lot more farmers of every generation and every ethnicity is an incredibly important strategy. And I think water is going to be the currency of the time ahead. I think actually, you know, I think we're entering into an economy that's both the relationship economy and a water economy, and that water is the most valuable thing we could be paying attention to right now, as well as reconnecting our web of relations, because I think that's the only real security, actually, is being connected with each other.
Yeah, is that Barry out there? Yeah.
Hey. Oh, hi, Barry.
Really good question. That's why we're doing this World We Want and How to Get There, and inviting, you know, a lot of people to participate in that. But you know, I didn't get to talk about it, but nature does not favor centralization, right? If you look at, the reason is very simple, that if things are too tightly connected and too concentrated, if there's the system crashes, the whole system crashes all at once. So that's why you find nature to be very decentralized and have actually quite a few redundancies where things are, you know, stashed in a number of places one way or the other. In industrial design, you know, redundancy is considered an inefficiency, right? So it's a very, very different viewpoint. So what we're already seeing and going to see much more of is a much greater decentralization. That means distributed clean energy at local and regional levels. It means much more localized food systems. And they'll never be entirely local, nor should they be. I mean, that's not the way it's going to work. But, you know, the same goes for economies, building much more localized economies that really feed the, and, you know, the data are all there about how much better it is when money stays in a community and actually circulates. So I think that at large is going to be the key word. We've moved beyond sustainability to resilience, because we're in for massive change now, and what you want to do is be able to continue to adapt. So these are keys to resilience, and we started this program, I guess 2001, I'm not sure, but what was originally called the Beaming Bioneers of local, what began as conferences and then evolved in many cases into year-round initiatives, such as what goes on here with Bluegrass Bioneers. And we're now knitting that into a very deliberate network as a learning and action network, because a lot of people are figuring stuff out in one place, but then it doesn't migrate. Mm-hmm. It just stays there. So we need to have kind of a living laboratory of communities of practice that is a learning and action network, where people start to say, like Nina mentioned, Spokane, what they've done is to design a community bill of rights based on a lot of stuff that would be obvious, like a living wage and things of that nature, but or worker rights. But what they've done is to revoke corporate personhood and institute rights for nature. The first time on the ballot, and Spokane is a very red city. Yeah. I mean, very, very conservative, second largest city in Washington state. The first time on the ballot, they got 24% of the vote. And the second time, despite massive corporate out-of-state money that came in, including the National Chamber of Commerce, they got 49.2% of the vote, right? So it's going to tip. It's coming. So we did a conference call with a bunch of our, resilient communities, Beaming Bioneers communities, to share not just the template — anybody can get the template on the web — but to ask the organizers to explain how they went about it, what were the challenges that came, the blowback, the barriers, how do you actually organize? So that's, we're instituting a whole series of stuff around that, in the belief that, Tip O'Neill, the famous politician, once said, "All politics is local." Well, at one level, all ecology is local too, right? You've got your food shed, your water shed, your energy shed, and you've also got your culture shed, right? And bluegrass is not the same as, for example, Salt Lake City, So anyway, that's something. Biomimicry is already starting to really move into major business channels and is going to become huge as a basic in the design arena. The Living Building Challenge, which probably some of you are familiar with, Jason McLennan, and you could Google that on the web, but it's a whole different level of what building means, of being part of the environment and actually matching nature's services, buildings that have all their own energy, recycle, blah, blah, anyway, go on. the rights of nature is a game changer. If we don't deal with some of the corporate power issues, the rest is commentary. That has to change and is changing, I think. I think there's a lot of other inner things that need to happen right now. And when you think back to 9/11 in New York, George W. Bush at the time told everybody to go shopping. That was the response, if you remember, right? Which was, talk about a non-starter. And so what people wanted to do was to grieve and to commune with each other. And they created altars and shrines, and people were relating to each other on the street. And it was a profound, profound time. And it's never really gone away in that sense. And I think we're, as Dr. Bernie Siegel, the cancer surgeon, said, pain is God's reset button, right? And we're going to be brought to our knees. I mean, the loss, the dislocation, the suffering, it's not just nature that's hurting, it's people, big time. And so I think we're going to be brought back to our most basic values. And, the most basic value, what we talk about is this declaration of interdependence. Oneness is real. This is a fact of life. And I think that that's the shift in consciousness and the change of heart that's already underway, that I think what you're doing here is so, so important. And I was very moved and very startled, actually, by a comment I think that Owsley made yesterday about that we're having these conversations in public, and then in private we're having really different conversations. And that is so, so true. And I've been having that identical experience, and we've been consciously talking about that with Bioneers, that we need to bring that out front, those much deeper, much more human conversations. And so I really believe what you're doing here is incredibly important. And for me, I believe the faith community is actually one of the most important political forces on the planet right now. 80% of the world's people, and enormous resources as well, but that's even less important than the human element of that. And I think, you know, when you get down to it, that's about values and about connection and what our cosmology is and recognizing that truly we are all one, you know? And so anyway.
Wonderful. We have a question here.
Yeah. So I've been to 5 of the 6 last Bioneers conferences in San Rafael, what they call the Headwaters Conference. And I always have trouble telling my friends exactly what it is and why they should go. So I wonder if Kenny and Nina could do that succinctly. I would like to see all of you there.
Well, let me first just recognize that's Polly Howells. And Polly is recently the chair of our board and currently serving as a board member of Bioneers. So thank you, Polly. And if you have questions about Bioneers, please ask Polly.
She'll
get practice at saying what it is. But, you know, I find that I describe Bioneers differently depending on who I'm talking to. But one of the ways that I describe it is that it is this collection of practitioners of visionary and practical solutions for helping heal our relations with ourselves, each other, and the earth. Another way that I sometimes describe it is that we do like an environmental and social star search to identify really leading edge projects and people whose ideas we think have tremendous transformative power and that everyone needs to know about because the mainstream media tends to cover the bad news but not the good news. So really we identify, we make visible the world that's possible today. And I think that that's, you know, as I've lived with it for a long time, I've found that that's of incredible value.
Yeah, basically, you know, I mean, people ask what's the elevator speech, and it doesn't really fit into a soundbite. I always ask, how many floors are we going up? I hope it's the penthouse. But, you know, the flip answer that I give is Bioneers is a natural antidepressant. And, you know, I mean, it is so clear, the solutions are so profound, and the people are so brilliant, and there's so much heart that you can't help but being hopeful from the experience. It's like an altered state or something. And, you know, a friend who is sort of the shadow co-founder of Bioneers once called it the Church of Bioneers, actually. And in the best sense, I think, you know, it is that. But our focus this year is really around growing the movement because we believe that's what it's going to come down to now. This really has matured. The work has reached a tipping point and a point of maturation where it is absolutely ready to go to scale. And, you know, there are some areas where we don't know exactly what to do, but we definitely know what directions to head in. And if there were real resources put behind this and political will, it would move. It would move really quickly. And Jay Harmon, whom I mentioned, the spiral biomimic guy earlier, I talked with him a few years ago. We took a little mini Bioneers to Hong Kong to talk to Chinese mayors. It was really interesting, all over China. And the mayors in China, by the way, were out competing each other for who was greener. It was an incredible experience. Seriously. I mean, when the irony is this, you know, essentially authoritarian state with the stroke of a pen, if China says we're going green, they're going green, man. It was amazing to witness. But so anyway, Jay said, you know, I said, so what would it take to really put biomimicry over the top? And he said, basically, there's some basic science that we really haven't been able to do. It would cost between $1 and $3 billion that would unleash an industry like the world has never seen. $1 to $3 billion isn't even a rounding error in a federal budget. I mean, seriously, you know, they dropped that on, you know, that's pocket change in Congress, right? So I don't care if it's the US or China or Brazil, I mean, we're pushing that wherever we go, you know? I mean, who's gonna step up and change the course of history with one stroke of a pen? So, I mean, that's the kind of thing we're really looking for and hoping to elicit from our whole amazing, you know, community. And I think the other thing that happens for me at Bioneers that is sort of indescribable, but the main hall holds about 2,000 people, And, you know, the truth is, if you scratch the surface, there are a lot of fault lines, right? There are the Luddites and the techno-utopians. There are people who are spiritually oriented and people who are adamantly secular, right? I mean, you can go down the list. And that's what's held us back so much in many ways, is those divisions and those separations. And I think what we're able to do is to create a field where nature is at the center for all of us, because we are children of Mother Earth, and there's extraordinary reverence and wonder involved in that. Yet at the same time, there's a tremendous sense of solidarity and common ground, and that we are all rowing in the same direction, and that's the intention. And so that's to me the magic of it, is to be able to have that occur. And one of the most interesting experiences I had a few years ago, we offer as many scholarships as we can, and particularly to a lot of indigenous youth and people of color and low-income folks and elders and students and all of that, as much as we can get money for. And so this one really tough-looking Latino kid was standing outside the exhibit hall in the afternoon with big tattoos all over his arms, and was clearly there with Bioneers. He wasn't from Marin County, you know, that was clear. And so I was just, you know, really happy he was there, and I just went over to say hello. And he kind of looked me deep in the eye and said, you know, I'm like super critical. I always find everything that's wrong, and I can't find anything that's wrong with this. I really like this. So that was wonderful to hear, but I'm always, you know, I really want to understand what people are responding to exactly. So I pressed him a little bit about that, and he said, that spiral guy. You know, it wasn't about social justice. It was like, wow, the signature of the cosmos is the spiral, and I'm part of that. You know, and I think that's kind of what this is about here right now, you know.
Yeah.
So, and I think that's ultimately what's going to get us through, that sense that we are all from that source. So
I just want to add one thing, because I'm not sure I've said it clearly enough, and it's become really important to me, is to say that I came very late in my life to this work around women and the feminine. And for the last 5 or 6 years, I've been lucky enough to attend the UN Commission on the Status of Women and really research and explore what are women achieving all over the world. And what I found consistently is that the data is in. What's happening around the world is that coalitions of grassroots women are making the most profound ecological and social change. It's happening in Liberia, it's happening all over, and in Kenya, and there are extraordinary examples of it. And so part of my vision and my dedication and my enthusiasm and my hope is trusting that as we all come into our own voices and our own leadership more fully, that we can really create a network of diverse women across generations, across ethnicities, across disciplines, because together I really believe we can be unstoppable, and that we're part of the transformative mojo that's needed in this time to help shift our culture towards a life-affirming, sacred, and healthy future.
So. Can I just add one quick thing to that? So yeah, I want to add my 2 cents to that, which is that
you're on the stage with 3 women.
Whoa,
we're over time.
Surrounded. So I've lived with this for a while, but I've been working on I'm doing a film project that has nothing whatsoever to do with Bioneers, but. It's about this, or based on the work of this guy, Richard Tarnas. I don't know if you would know him, Tarnas, who wrote 2 sort of magnum opus books. And one of them, the first one, is called The Passion of the Western Mind. And it's the most extraordinary deconstruction of Western civilization that I've ever come across. And very fair and balanced. I mean, it's not a hit job at all. It's truly thoughtful. But anyway, clearly Western civilization has had an enormous shadow, along with many great things that have come from it. You know, it's a shadow that has basically led us to land's end today and threatens to destroy civilization as we know it. So you get to the end of this book and you're kind of wondering, okay, Rick, what does it all mean, you know? And what he said is that the single biggest signature of Western civilization is that almost the entire pantheon is masculine. And that has represented this extreme version of that, to the exclusion of the other, the feminine, you know, people of color, whatever the other is in that way. And in a sense, if there's one trim tab that kind of changes everything, it is about that rebalancing of the masculine and feminine. And what we know from studies and data today, I mean, it's women all over the world. This is happening spontaneously. It's not that it's an organized movement even as such. It's a zeitgeist, an idea whose time has come, that women everywhere are rising up in different ways. And what the data show is that when you get about 30% women in any given context, it shifts the whole thing. And that the values change, the priorities change, and the actions change. And so, you know, if I were going to focus on one single thing at this point, it would actually be exactly that, and what you know, Nina has been promoting and trying to convince me of for years. So,
so in the spirit of that, maybe Nina, you could actually bring this to a close with the ringing of our singing bowl. But just prior
thank
to,
you all.
To
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
You all
thank
have been
you.
Tremendously inspirational. Thank you. And I will mention there's a book signing, a book signing, and a reception to follow. And we look forward to seeing you tomorrow.
Thank you for sharing this time with us.
Yeah. Sorrow.